My name's Tom Quayle, and today I'm going to try and help you stick some chromaticism into your lead guitar playing. So let's work out what we mean by chromaticism. So the way we're going to do this is I'm going to take a G major scale, our simple G major scale, three note per string, goes like this. That's a very simple scale, and chromaticism means whenever we see a gap like this within the scale, we're going to fill that gap in, okay? Now this is a really simple version of chromaticism. Over the coming few months, we're going to look at some more involved methods of chromaticism, but to start with, let's keep things simple so we have a nice foundation. And literally all I'm going to do, whenever we have a gap, or mostly when we have a gap, not all the gaps, we're going to fill in with a spare finger, okay? So for instance, if we look at the first three notes of our G major scale, on our E string, we have 3, 5, and 7. So we actually have a gap in between our first and second fingers, there it is, fret 4, and a gap, if I move my third finger out of the way, in between the 5th and the 7th frets, there it is at the 6th fret. And actually this is the one we're going to fill in. So we're actually going to go, instead of 3, 5, 7, we're going to go 3, 5, 6, 7, okay, like this. Now if we continue this onto the A string, onto the next string, again we get 3, 5, 6, 7, and the 6 is our chromatic note. It's the note that's not normally within the scale. So we get this from the E string, 3, 5, 6, 7, 3, 5, 6, 7. Let's hear that. Okay, now when we move to the D and the G strings, we're going to repeat the same process. However, because we've got basically the gap's now moved, our gap is in between our second and fourth fingers, we're going to fill that gap in and get four notes or four frets in a row. So we get 4, 5, 6, 7. So all we're doing is filling in the gap in the scale. We do the same thing on the G string, and then the same thing on the B string. So you're going to go 5, 6, 7, 8. My guitar's tuned ever so slightly differently. I'm going to do this a semitone lower than you guys because my top two strings are C and F. So you're going to go 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, I'm going to go 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, I'm going to do the same thing on the E string, 5, 6, 7, 8 for you guys. A little bit different for me, 4, 5, 6, 7. So what I've got now is a G major scale, but I've filled in the majority of the gaps within the scale, so we get this. And the amazing thing is, we've actually just played all 12 notes of a chromatic scale. We've not played them in order, but we've played all 12 possible tones from A, A sharp, B, C, C sharp, D, D sharp, E, F, F sharp, G, G sharp, back to A. All 12 notes. Let me do it one more time. So long as we finish on this note, which is the 7th fret on the E string for you guys, it sounds like a G major scale. Have a listen one more time. It sounds like G major. So we've got that G major sound, even though we're throwing chromaticism in. So the point with this kind of chromaticism is that you can see gaps within your scale shapes and feel free to fill them in. The idea is that the contour or the shape of the scale and the notes contained within the scale will give you the general sound of that particular scale, but the chromatic notes will add more interest. Okay, so if we then take the next mode in our G major scale, which is A Dorian, and do the same thing, our A Dorian would normally sound like this. When we put the chromatic notes in, I'm going to fill in some of the gaps, we get this. So I'm just filling in gaps, and the general guideline is, if you start with each finger spread apart by one fret, you get this particular fingering, fill in the gap with the third finger. If you start with either of these two shapes, where you've got first, second, and little finger, or first, third, and little finger, fill in the gap in between. So first, second, and little finger, use the third finger to fill in. First, third, and fourth finger, use the second finger to fill in. Now, when we use this in our improvisations, what we can do is we can completely at will, you decide to do this or not to do it, you can fill in those gaps within your legato lines. I'm dealing with legato, you may be picking yourself, and you'll get some really nice chromatic sounds, either ascending or descending. So this is one method that we can do to get chromaticism. It's a very simple method, but players such as Brett Garr said employ this, I employ this all the time. It's not majorly sophisticated, it's not like jazz chromaticism at this stage, but it's still incredibly useful. So what I'm going to do now, we're going to play a track. This is an A Dorian track, kind of a funk feel. I'm just going to move to an overdriven sound. I'm just going to improvise around an A Dorian scale, nice and slowly to start with, then speed things up and add some chromaticism in as I go. And the majority of the lines that I'm going to play are just based around those three fingerings, either this one, where I fill in the gap, or the stretched fingering, where I fill in the gap again with my third finger, or based around a first, second, and fourth finger, where I fill in the gap with the third finger, but all based around the A Dorian scale. Okay, so let's play the track. I'll do a little bit of improvisation. First thing I'll do is just go up the scale, then I'll start to improvise for you. So here we go, here's the track. Okay, so as you can hear, using the chromaticism doesn't take us outside of that A Dorian sound. If anything, what it does is enhance the sound because it makes us sound a little bit more sophisticated. So let me just show you really quickly a few different patterns that you could play that are really simple within that chromatic structure. You don't just have to ascend and descend through the scale. So let's start on the G string. We're going to use an A Dorian again. I want you to start with your first finger on the fifth fret of the G string. Now the most obvious thing to do would be, there's our fingering, 5th fret, 7th fret, 9th fret, so 1st, 2nd and 4th finger. The most obvious thing to do would be to go straight through those notes and add the 3rd fingering chromatically, so you get this. Okay, but how about mixing those notes up? Let's keep the chromatic nature, but let's start with the 1st finger and then go to the little finger and then pull off back through those chromatic notes, so we get this. Okay, so we could combine these approaches and we could go up through the chromatic, straight up the scale on one string and then back using this new pattern on the next string. So if I start on the D string, I could play 5, 7, 8, 9. That's straight up chromatically. Then on the G string, what I could do is use our new pattern. So that would give us this, which is much more interesting than just going straight up and down. There's other patterns you could use. Why not do this? And use a combination of like a pedal tone on the fifth fret of the G string, and then bring those other chromatic notes in one at a time. So that was 5, hammer onto 7, pull back off to 5, hammer onto 8, pull back off to 5, hammer onto 9, pull back off to 5, which would give you this. So we could ascend through the D string again and then use our new pattern. Again, very cool sound. It's just getting creative with how you use these chromatic notes. So it's quite a simple concept, and the way I recommend you do it is you take each of your modes and you play up and down through the scale using 3 notes per string at this stage, filling in the gaps, getting used to how this sounds, getting your ears used to it and getting your fingers used to it. Try and make it flow nicely. We want to keep a good constant 16th or triplet pulse depending on what you're going for. Make sure you feel the time correctly. And make sure that you're playing smoothly and that you're using good technique, whether you're picking or whether you're playing legato. When you first do these, practice them nice and slowly like we talked about in my last column. so that you're not working too hard too quickly and getting the timing all wrong and the technique wrong. So you need to take your time with this. Okay, so hopefully this will be useful to you. What we're going to do next time is expand upon this and try and look at some ideas that jazz musicians use to make their chromaticism more involved and more sophisticated. So I'll see you next time. Thanks for listening. Bye-bye.
We all have some of our favorite songs we'd like to learn note for note. At licklibrary.com, you'll find hundreds of note for note lessons to great songs. As a member, you'll get unlimited access to all these lessons, plus much more. At licklibrary.com, the original online musicians community.